Let me kind of fill you in just a little bit on where we were as far as authoring the book. And we were asked, I was asked probably 5 years ago to consider writing the book. I kind of dodged the bullet for 2 or 3 years. And finally, after I dodged so long, I just kind of felt like I needed to quit dodging, I guess. I asked Wanda Ram if she would help, and Wanda has been a great help in the book, as well as many other things from town of Knightdale over the years. Her grandparents were original family here. She was president of the Chamber of Commerce, did a lot of things for the town many years ago, and continues to do. But one of the things that was real interesting to us, the publisher has some very strict guidelines that we had to follow, and we probably did not agree with many of them. But nevertheless, we were able to get by. One of the things that the young lady that was working with us from the publishing company seemed to think that we could walk out on the streets of Knightdale and asked the first person we saw, like Don Dean, give me an original photograph from about 1910 of your family. And she felt like that everybody had one. You know, we had a lot of old copies. We had a lot of fuzzy pictures. We sent 180 pictures in at one time. They bounced 60 of them back and said they were not acceptable quality-wise. One of the things that I always felt a history book that goes back to the early 1900s could stand a few fuzzy pictures, but the publisher didn't like fuzzy pictures apparently, and when you get your book you won't see many fuzzy pictures. There'll be some pictures in there that we would like to have had in the book. We just couldn't get them to accept them, but we want to thank those who did provide photographs for us and worked hard to find things that we could use. Christine House up front here provided us with several of the older pictures that we were able to use. Peggy Andrews, sitting right here in the front, was a lifesaver, Peggy.
Absolutely.
You have seen her line drawings over the years of the older parts of Knightdale, and she graciously let us use some of those in the book. Had it not been for those pictures that you let us use, we just would not have had enough numbers to make the book. So Peggy, thank you so much.
I appreciate it.
And I'm going to turn it over to Wanda and let her talk a little bit. And those of you that know Wanda are going to be very surprised that she can't talk much tonight. So you might be blessed.
Well, I declare.
She was a great co-author.
We laughed a lot.
Didn't we?
Living here on this land with Grandmama growing up, when something would happen that, you know, could be upsetting, she'd say, well, you might as well laugh as to cry. And so we followed that, because there were times that, my goodness, they said, oh, mail us all those pictures. We'll scan them. Mail people's 100-year-old pictures? I don't think so. I said, no, we're not going to do that. Well, this picture is absolutely not acceptable. It can't be used. Hand me a book. And they said, no, you can't use this one that is now the cover. And so he took them down there, and because Libby would restrain him and he wouldn't do anything he shouldn't. And I had to teach. And so then I said, y'all just pick a cover. I don't care. And then here it came back. And I thought, oh, that picture we couldn't use. I learned a lot of things. I learned that if your name is Rufus, I'm kin to you. And you can't sling a dead cat without hitting a Rufus in this town. Even my great aunt Betty Knight, Betty Rufus Smith Knight. Now, what was my great granddaddy thinking? You name your dog Rufus. You do not name your daughter Rufus. It's bad enough to have all those Rufuses, you know, male, and they're everywhere in our family. So I did. We, every time, in fact, when we call each other now, we don't answer the phone normally because, well, we're not normal, but hey, Rufus, how you doing? And it doesn't matter who answers. You know, we say that to the other one because we might as well be named that. Everybody else is. So we did learn a whole lot. I learned about machinery from the, when is that picture of Little John?
In the 40s.
So in the 40s, I wasn't around. My students would be shocked to know there was a time I wasn't around, but I wasn't. And I didn't understand gas pumps from that time. And there's a picture of Little John Massey, and he was little then, and Juanita's hand is ready to grab him lest he get into something or jump off the edge of that car. And behind him is a gas pump. And I learned that you pumped it and filled up this top part, and there it was marked as to how much gas you were putting up there, and then ran it into your car. I didn't know that. Had no idea. So we did learn a whole lot. It was very interesting to learn what had been where. I didn't know there was a Betterment Association to raise money for hot lunches for the schools, and that Nightdale was the first school in the rural school to have hot lunches. I didn't know that. Had no idea. I hadn't heard that from even my mother or my grandmother. So there, you know, just so many things that you run into along the way. I didn't know why some of the town was laid out like it was. I thought that the little tiny lots on Hester Street and all along in there were because the railroad had laid them out. And I was wrong. My great aunt ended up doing it because he died before it could be finished. But that was laid out because of the way they wanted to be able to service the businesses, they thought, from the back, but it turned out to be residences. I didn't know. Just amazing to find things. I also had no idea. Well, I didn't have any idea somebody named their child Mito. That man needed slapping right there on general principle. But I found this document that said that Betty Smith Knight and Mito Jones were taken separately into a room with the Justice of the Peace and questioned to be sure they had not been coerced in any way into signing the right-of-way for the railroad to come through. And I said to Billy, well, if they were coerced, do you think they'd tell it? And he said, well, now, we don't know Mito. We don't know a thing about her except, you know, she's got a claim against her family for that name. But you know the women in your family, how many have been coerced? None. Doesn't happen. So I said, okay, you got a point. I'm pretty sure Betty was not, because that wouldn't happen. But it was just, it was fascinating to look at the things from our history and to see all that people did to have a town and to have schools and to grow it like it is now. You know, giving time, often giving money, certainly giving manpower, and lots of woman power for that matter. And I know one way they did that. That just occurred to me. They didn't have to worry a lot with how they looked, because when you see these folks in these books, you go, they didn't worry a lot about how they looked, did they? And they were out working, and that's got to be it. But we just, they were. I didn't know that the first water line was a half inch or three quarters?
Three quarters.
Three quarters inch water line.
The main. For
the main one for the town. Huh. Think about our water pressure, and we get a little upset now when it's not really putting out. And you imagine that the person next to it got some water and everybody else went, sure wish we could have a drip, just a little bit. So there's just a lot to be learned and so much to be proud of with the people that did volunteer and you know, give so much of themselves. And that was fascinating. I learned that Malby's Church, which I'd been told all my life, my grandfather gave the land as long as it was used for a church. Well, my granddaddy died in 1956, and I thought, well, let me just look over here at Malby's website and see what we got. Well, they credited a man named George High, and I thought, well, that's not what I heard. So I called or emailed, well, I Googled granddaddy. Now, the man died in 1956. Up pops a picture of him and grandmama I had never seen. findagrave.com. If you've got somebody that's missing, go there. And I said, I emailed my cousin and said, weren't we all told this? And what's the truth? Neither. It was done when it was a plantation, and in order to buy the land, in the future, people that bought it had to agree to that church being there. I didn't know that. So it's quite an education. And you'll see people that you know or people that you think you know, and you think, really? Is that who that is? And there were people that I declare to this day, I think that one woman isn't a woman, I declare. But I know they didn't Photoshop pictures back then, but the head doesn't fit right. And it made me, and I said, I said it to somebody I probably shouldn't have. I said, Lord have mercy, that's an ugly woman. And she said, that's my great whoever. And I thought, I said, well, they got much better as the years went on. Because what are you going to say? Your foot's already in your mouth up to your knee. So it was fun. When it got really bad, and I would call and say, well, guess what? We can't use this, 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 this. Or it doesn't fit the layout planner. It's due tomorrow. I'll be at your house in a minute. And I'd take back off over there, and Libby would sit there and laugh at us because we would get tickled. She said, I don't know how you all do this, but laughing worked. It got us there. Now, he also didn't tell you he has this wonderful talent in his eyes. Libby and I may disagree. He believes that there's at least three ways to spell every word. And there we'll use all of them on the same page. Oh, yeah. And then I look at, and of course, then it's handwritten. There's a reason I don't take handwriting from my students, and I looked at that and I thought,
you can't read cursive.
I can't read chicken scratch. But yeah, that was entertaining, to say the least. And then when we were at town hall last week, he mentioned that, and Russell said, Juan, we feel your pain. And I thought, oh, you've had to read it. But it's overall, it's been trying at times, wouldn't you say? I know that my son got tired of just the fact that we were always working on this book. And I'd say, oh, they don't like this now. And he's like, good grief. I got tired of that myself. And one day hung up on the woman. And she called me back and said, did you hang up on me? And I thought, well, the line went dead. What do you think? I had a migraine and a crazy publisher at the same time. So anyway, it's done and we're delighted. And I will hush and you can do whatever it is you need to do. Don't write. Please don't write.
I now know why they're not teaching cursive in school. Because the college professors can't read it.
That's us. We don't wish to.
You know, one of the things that was really interesting to me, oh, and by the way, Dustin and Seth, I found just 4 days ago the contract for the town of Knightdale, which I'll get you a copy of, for the first 10 streetlights that were installed in Knightdale, 1927, I believe. Don't hold me to that date. But anyway, the contract was in the attic of my Uncle Robert's house at the time. Apparently he was town clerk, and the contract was there, and I just got it last week. And one of the things that was interesting to me, talking about the first Knightdale school the first one was on the Knight Plantation up here across from where where the trailer park is, a mobile home park on the other side of the Knight House. But then the first Knightdale school was sitting on the site that Pete Bangham's house that he's been remodeling on First Avenue. That's where the school was set. But one of the things that was really interesting that we read in a newspaper from Ms. Maggie Eddings, some of you will remember Ms. Maggie. She moved to Knightdale as a little girl. It took all day and into the night for them to drive from Wilson to Knightdale. Now, this was a long time ago. But the thing that interested her the most, when she came to the new Knightdale school It had two rooms, and it had a place to hang your coat. And she was really impressed because she came from a one-room schoolhouse in Wilson County back to Knightdale to live, and she lived the rest of her life here. But, you know, we think about those kind of things, and we think, well, surely that couldn't have happened. But she wrote about it very joyfully, how happy she was to get the chance to come to a two-room schoolhouse that had a place that you could hang up your clothes, your coats when you came to school.